Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is a debate without motion on the subject of skills and opportunities to support recovery, Young Persons Guarantee and National Training Transition Fund, 1 year on. I would invite those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now, and I call on Jamie Hepburn, Minister, to open the debate. Around 11 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, President Officer. On the 8th of October 2020, the Scottish Government launched the National Transition Training Fund, and in the following month, we set out to partner the ambitions for the Young Persons Guarantee. President Officer, at the outset of my contribution today, I want to reiterate my gratitude and that of the Government to Sandy Begbie for the work he has done in developing and leading on the guarantee. His passion and enthusiasm has been evident throughout, and I'm delighted he continues to advance the guarantee and has also taken on the role of National Chair of Developing Young Workforce, emphasising his commitment to young people. President Officer, I'm very pleased to have the opportunity today to highlight how, through our partnership, working with local government, our agencies, the third sector, our teachers, lecturers, trainers, key workers and employers, we are delivering on our ambitions. On this, our one-year anniversary of the Young Persons Guarantee, I'll also outline the collaborative next steps that we are taking to deliver skills and training opportunities that are supporting our COVID recovery and this Government's wider efforts to bring about a fairer future. Throughout the pandemic, we have sought to alleviate the overall harm caused by the virus to our health, to our economy and to broader society. As we move forward with recovery, we must ensure that we build on the strong foundations we have in our skills system and have appropriate support to deliver training opportunities to develop the skills that individuals and businesses need now and into the future. Last month, the Deputy First Minister launched the Scottish Government's COVID recovery strategy. This focused on the efforts needed to tackle inequality and disadvantage and the actions required to ensure the type of recovery that people, communities and our economy want and need. The strategy recognises that many critical sectors across the Scottish economy are reporting issues with the supply of labour resulting from the exit from the EU. From food and drink to hospitality to transport to social care, we are working with business organisations to help employers fill vacancies. Our employability programmes, upskilling and retraining interventions and Fair Work tools provide a package of support for employers and for workers interested in moving into these jobs. We're also developing our new 10-year national strategy for economic transformation, which focuses on the economic future we want to see, a greener, fairer and more inclusive wellbeing economy. This approach will help meet our 2030 climate targets, help restore the natural environment, stimulate innovation, create jobs, improve wellbeing for all and further embed fair work standards across the economy. The delivery of economic transformation requires that the people of Scotland have the opportunity to acquire the right skills. Throughout the pandemic, we have sought to recognise and understand the challenges faced by individuals and businesses in order to develop the right interventions to meet their skills needs. The National Transition Training Fund, introduced as a specific response to COVID-19's effect on the labour market, is just one example of how we move quickly to target our support to those individuals and sectors most need. Briefly.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving me. He stated that everyone should be given the opportunity, but the National Transition Training Fund creates opportunities for around 40,000 people, but there's 120,000 people unemployed. Indeed, there were 80,000 people on furlough when that scheme finished. Does he think that response is sufficient, or does he think that more places will need to be created?
Minister.
Well, what I would say to Mr. Johnson is that the National Transition Training Fund is only one element of the entirety of the system that we have. That's why I made the point at the outset that the National Transition Training Fund, Young Persons Guarantee, build on the strong foundations we have. So I recognise and understand the point he makes, and it's an entirely valid point, but the response I would give to him is that we don't rely just on the National Transition Training Fund. We, of course, have the Flexible Workforce Development Fund. We have individual training accounts. We have our wider tertiary education offer. So it has to be placed in that context as well. And indeed, that is the point I made when I said it's just one example of how we target our support to individuals and sectors most in need. But looking at the National Transition Training Fund, last year's funding had a number of different strands, including individual support for those aged 25 and over who were made unemployed or whose jobs were under threat because of COVID-19. And we know that training has been well received. For example, the feedback from the participants in the Tourism and Hospitality Talent Development Programme was overwhelmingly positive. As well as supporting individuals, the National Transition Training Fund has helped sectors to enhance the skills of their existing labour force. Our partners have delivered a range of interventions that have positively supported a myriad of Scotland's most important and dynamic sectors, from tourism and hospitality to green construction to aerospace decommissioning and forestry. Overall, in year one, with some final figures to be confirmed, up to 9,000 people have benefited from training opportunities. A final year one report will be published early next year. This year, we've given the National Transition Training Fund a broader role in supporting Scotland's economic recovery, addressing the impact of EU exit and responding to demand for future skills transitions, including in the transition to net zero. We've sought to apply the lessons learned from the first year of delivery to ensure the funding responds to economic needs, committed up to £20 million in funding to support individuals and sectors across over 30 projects. This funding will support up to 20,000 individuals and will offer specific assistance to sectors in need of support, such as aviation, social care and digital skills. I recently visited West Lothian College to hear from staff and students about the Gateway to Health and Social Care course, a skills boost course funded by the National Transition Training Fund and developed by the college in collaboration with the Scottish Ambulance Service. It provided a skills intervention to a number of participants who moved from different sectors to support our mobile testing centres, who now want to stay in the health sector. This is a fantastic initiative and a great example of how our colleges work in partnership to create courses that respond to the needs of sectors and individuals. Like the National Transition Training Fund, partnership working is critical to the ambitions of our Young Persons Guarantee. As a government, we are delivering on our commitment to young people, providing up to £130 million for the Young Persons Guarantee, which builds on our existing investment in education skills and training. The funding will support 24,000 new enhanced employment training and education opportunities for young people, with a particular focus on supporting those who face additional challenges in participating in the labour market. The Young Persons Guarantee is youth-focused and employer-led. I'm delighted to announce that we now have over 300 employers signed up to the guarantee who are generating in excess of 6,000 additional opportunities. This movement of employers continues to grow, and I encourage all businesses and all sectors to get involved. Employers are looking to their local communities to recruit young workers, and alongside developing a young workforce, are supporting the workforce of the future and our just transition towards our net zero targets. Our national approach to the introduction of developing young workforce skills coordinators is creating increased work-based learning for pupils and strengthening collaborative working with local employers. In recognition of the need for tailored support for some of our young people, we're providing additional funding to enable an intercultural Youth Scotland to support disabled young people and young people from minority ethnic communities in schools. Meanwhile, our local employability partnerships are working across Scotland to change the lives of young people in their communities, from Dumfries and Galloway's growing rural talent project to Orkney's work with Who Cares Scotland to improve the lives of care-experienced young people. These partnerships are also supporting young people who face challenges entering the labour market into fair and sustainable employment through employer recruitment incentives we've put in place, delivered through local employability partnerships. As part of a number of events that are taking place to mark the first anniversary of the Young Persons Guarantee, I was in Inverness yesterday, where I had the pleasure of meeting Capgemini, one of the first employers to sign up to the guarantee. In collaboration with the local college there, growing the company with local talent, recognising the pathway progression from foundation apprenticeships to their modern apprenticeship programme. A core part of their involvement centres not only on a desire to be a good actor in supporting young people in their area, but also in identifying talent to fill the vacancies they have in their organisation. That's a message I would like to reaffirm to employers. The Young Persons Guarantee and developing young workforce more generally are certainly a way to give back to young people, but also a massive recruitment opportunity. It is an employer's own enlightened self-interest to get involved. I'll certainly give way.
Michael Mara.
Thank the Minister for giving way. You may be aware that last night saw the first meeting of the cross-party group on maritime and shipbuilding in the Parliament. And one of the areas that was of particular concern to the industry was the significant skills gaps that they see in bringing people through. Will the Minister commit to engaging with that sector and making sure that we can deal with that issue?
Minister.
First of all, I should readily concede I was unaware of the meeting of the cross-party group, but I'd be very happy to engage with that sector, as I'm happy to engage with any sector that is willing to give opportunities to young people to get into the world of work. President Officer, as well as meeting employers next Wednesday as part of Scotland's First Carers Careers Week, I am looking forward to meeting a youth panel at the Public Sector and Healthcare Conference and discussing what the guarantee can do for them. Strengthening careers advice and ensuring that every door remains open for every young person is an important part of the guarantee. The former General Secretary of the Scottish Trade Union Congress and current board member of Skills Development Scotland, Graeme Smith, is leading a review into career advice and information, as recommended by Sandy Begbie, with recommendations due shortly. As well as taking forward this range of actions, it is vital that understanding how the support delivered through the guarantee is achieved is achieving improved outcomes for young people. Our monitoring and evaluation framework, which is due for publication next month, will support our understanding of the impact of the guarantee across a range of economic, education and equalities outcomes. President Officer, this is only a part of our effort to support people to get the skills they require in a changing economy and to respond to our societal need. The Young Persons Guarantee and National Transition Training Fund sit alongside our wider tertiary education offer, individual training accounts and the Flex Workforce Development Fund, as I mentioned a few moments ago to Daniel Johnson. All too often, in the face of economic challenges, people have been left behind. Through our partnership working, I'm determined to not see that happen and that we work together to deliver a real and lasting impact.
Thank you. I now call on Pam Gozo. Around 7 minutes, please, Ms Gozo.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start today by welcoming the opportunity to debate such an important matter, particularly as we begin on our job-focused recovery from the devastating effects of the pandemic? Too often, apprenticeships can be seen as a second best to higher education. This is wrong. If anything, I am very grateful for having bypassed the traditional learning pathway in my own career. I am a very great advocate of different pathways into work because, Presiding Officer, there is not one route that suits all, and I think this is something that the whole Chamber will agree on. As Confucius once said, I hear and I forget. I see and I remember. I do and I understand. This quote is very relevant to the issue up for debate today. Training and apprenticeships are more important than ever. People must be able to learn and apply what they can learn into the world of work. Presiding Officer, a fall in unemployment rate is encouraging, but we face challenging times ahead, especially as we navigate through new developments in our job market that have emerged in response to the pandemic and our commitments to the greener economy and future. As we build back, I'm delighted that the National Transition Training Fund has been dedicated to helping people develop skills or retrain in the face of COVID-19 and move into growth sectors. However, in the survey conducted, 13% of respondents did not secure a job after training. We cannot just forget about that 13%. Can the Minister explain what is being done to foster a connection between individuals who have undergone training and businesses experiencing a skills shortage? Presiding Officer, I commend the aims of National Transition Training Fund. In immediate aftermath, it is possible that we will see an increase in new hires as they go back to pre-pandemic levels. However, without offering training based on demand from businesses, we risk the significant gaps and overlaps. More concerning than that, in May 2021, figures released by the Scottish Government put the number of individuals supported by the scheme around 3,000 rather than 6,000. The lack of consideration for what businesses actually need would also be responsible for the SNP's broken promise on 30,000 modern apprenticeships a year by 2020. The Minister excused the failure.
Certainly. Minister.
I hope she would recognise two things. First of all, that there was a year-on-year increase in the number of apprenticeships in Scotland, as opposed to what was happening south of the border, where there was a year-on-year decrease in the last few years. And she would also, hopefully, being a fair-minded person, recognise that the reason that target wasn't achieved in the year it was set, and it would have otherwise been, is because we were in the midst of a global pandemic and demand fell.
Pam Gozo.
You know, Minister, I look at basically every time we come in this chamber, we look at what the reason is. The reason is always behind COVID. But this fund was set up because we needed it in COVID, so it should have reached the targets we should have had. The fact that you had a target to reach for 6,000 and then you only reached 3,000, and now, you know, I can see that today you've reached up to 7,500. This still isn't enough. We've got 115,000 people facing long-term unemployment. We need to do much more. I want to make some progress with the speech, please. The Minister excused the failure under the cover of... Actually, this is quite relevant. The Minister excused the failure under the cover of coronavirus. This, as the SNP Scottish Government seems to be hiding behind effects of the pandemic for a lot of the policy failures recently. Yes, the COVID-19 pandemic has had an adverse impact on young people in employment. But even before the pandemic, the number of employers with STEM skill shortages were increasing. Even before the pandemic, the number of young people starting a modern apprenticeship has fallen for the 5 years in a row. Presiding officer, a demand-led approach to apprenticeships could have increased the number of both modern apprenticeships and the success rate of those finding a job upon completion of training. Not to mention the many graduates who have dedicated years of building up their skills to enter the workforce and have faced difficulty in securing a graduate apprenticeship, paid or otherwise. I understand that in an uncertain market, taking an apprentice is a commitment that some businesses are unable to make. However, for the same reason the National Transition Training Fund was created, it was and still is an important time to ensure that we are doing everything we can to advance people's lives, businesses and the economy. Once again, it has fallen to the... Once again, it has fallen to the opposition to do the numbers for the SNP. The First Minister announced a £15 million programme that would pay businesses £5,000 for each apprentice they would take on. But the numbers reveal that if the £15 million were divided by £5,000, only 3,000 young people would be supported by the apprenticeship programme. That is less than 6% of the unemployed young people. Does the Minister agree that their £15 million apprenticeship programme is inadequate in addressing the larger issue of unemployment? Listening to businesses and organisations such as CBI, they have all recommended a demand-led approach to apprenticeships. So I will ask them to commit to the demand-led approach. So I ask the Minister to commit to the demand-led approach moving forward.
Sorry, is that an intervention, Ms. Gilbert?
I'm genuinely perplexed as to what the member means by changing to a demand-led process for apprenticeships. We have a demand-led process for apprenticeships, and it's, again, seemingly inconsistent on the one hand to say we should have a demand-led system and then to dismiss the point I have made that the challenge we faced in reaching the 30,000 target was for the very reason that the demand wasn't there. How can she square that circle?
Pam Gozo.
Thank the Minister, obviously, for the question. When I talk about demand-led, if you're saying, sitting there, Minister, that it is demand-led, what the fund you've put together and how you're delivering it, then, to be honest, the only thing I can see then is that there's a problem in you marketing it and making businesses aware, because 13% fell through the gap, and these are real people, not just statistics. So you have to look at that. There has to be an issue then in the marketing or how you're making businesses aware. Our world is changing, new skills are needed, and businesses are looking ahead to the future. But can the Scottish Government keep up? Presiding officer, I'd like to close today by highlighting three key points. Firstly, the training offered by the National Transition Training Fund is not enough to secure individuals a job. Far more must be done, and fast. Secondly, a demand-led approach must be taken if we want to make apprenticeships more attractive for employers, especially during these unprecedented times. And lastly, Scotland's young people deserve every opportunity to prosper and thrive. They cannot become COVID's lost generation.
Thank you. I now call on Michael Mara. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr Mara.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The pace of technological change is the fastest it has ever been and the slowest it will ever be again. Economic change has been accelerated by the COVID-19 pandemic, and climate change demands that rather than searching for the brake, we put our foot on the accelerator. Further, deeper, more profound change. But the early days of this government's response does not bode well. The measures taken, as we've heard already, have been inadequate at best. And there's little surprise there, not just in terms of a 14-year track record of inadequate delivery, but it is difficult to find the right solution when you refuse to define the problem. There has been no robust analysis that has been conducted over the impact on attainment, on young people's experience of education, attainment and skills. This is the case in schools as it is in tertiary education, including those taking apprenticeships and other skills-based learning. The scale of lost learning, receding literacy and communication skills amongst the youngest pupils, the numbers of disengaged teenagers, Labour have raised these issues and the urgent need for a state of the nation analysis in this area time and again. There appears to be no appetite for this from the government or to face the reality that families and frontline workers are dealing with every day. We do not know the impact. Learning has been lost, there have been impact on aspirations, nor the potential knock-on to the skills gaps in the economy. We do not know either the full extent of the skills gaps that exist regionally or across different industries due to numerous incomplete skills audits, as admitted by Skills Development Scotland in Parliament in recent weeks. This results in an education recovery plan that amounts to little more than a cut and paste of existing policies, pilloried by those on the front line as utterly inadequate and detached from reality. All of these issues have been raised with the ministerial team. All have yet to see action. The unemployment rate for young people peaked at 10.1% this year, over double the national rate. There is little to no plan of substance for getting them into employment and equipping them with the skills for the future that is needed. Daniel Johnson has already pointed out the inadequate scale of the current interventions. The National Transition Training Fund and the Young Persons Guarantee amount to 44,000 opportunities, around a third of the total required. So when we do consider this recovery to a realignment of the economy following both Brexit and the pandemic, we need to consider that our skills system was not functioning well before either, and we need to consider that so we can design a system for the future. And that future must be strategic in its purpose. Look forward to the reality of the way that our economy is changing, where the opportunities lie, and be centred on the individual. And we cannot, for the sake of those children, be bogged down by any constant grievance or constitutional bickering that we too often hear around these issues of skill shortages. We know from the experience in my region, from the oil and gas industry, that the system often struggles to effectively upskill or reskill people into industries where they are needed. And bridging the gap between the current North Sea industry and the next will require significant government support at scale. But technology transitions throughout history show that labour follows opportunity rather than forecasts. Essentially, people will only retrain when the jobs are there. So a proactive industrial strategy is absolutely vital. And of course, we have seen the SNP government miss their own targets by some considerable distance when it comes to the creation of green jobs and within their own flagship employment, Fair Start Scotland. A key focus must be ensuring that our skills system aligns with the long-term needs and interests of the economy and the people of our country. And there could be nothing more important than digital skills and how pervasive they are in all parts of our economy in the future, and how woefully Scotland is equipped to embrace the jobs and growth of that future. Speaking to businesses in my home city of Dundee, there is a desperate need for software engineers, coders, developers, IT support, but no considerable skills base from which that need can be met. Literally hundreds of people in the city are missing out on these opportunities because this government is not equipping them with those skills. Whether you're hiring graduates, whether you're filling technical posts, or whether you're recruiting PhDs, far too often young Scots are not available. And sometimes, yes, that issue is complex. It requires careful planning and multi-agency coordination, as the Logan Review touched on, commissioned by this government, but sadly not particularly well enacted. But let's start with ensuring there's a higher computing class running in every secondary school with a qualified teacher to teach it. I would ask whether that is beyond the wit of this government. So I believe that the ideas, engagement and will is there from the private sector to engage on these issues. It is, after all, these firms who require the skills that we're talking about. But often they feel they are left to engage pretty much on their own, by themselves, on a basis forged more on opportunity than a cohesive structure, and that a fundamental appraisal is urgently needed from the government to get these structures right. Surely that must form thinking when we consider the funds and the guarantees that we assess today. Absolutely.
Claire Adamson. I'm sorry, Emma Harper.
Thank you, President Officer. You're talking about how there's been no support offered. I should say the member's talking about how there's been no support offered and that young people are doing this on their own. But I'm just reading that Dumfries and Galloway College, with support from the Scottish Government, are actively supporting young people to engage in digital courses. Wouldn't that be something that we should be recognising?
Mike Mara.
I think the scale of those interventions are completely inadequate in terms of what was required for the future of our economy, whether we're training in artificial intelligence, machine learning, training people to the highest degrees and making sure that we have software engineers, people that can actually work in these industries in the future. There are some limited interventions the government has taken, but they're entirely inadequate, as their own publication under the Logan Review recognised. Far more needs to be done. And what I was saying was that the private sector is ready, I believe, to engage in this, but more needs to be done to engage them, to talk about the skills gaps and what is required. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, there are many routes and options open to ensuring a better, more responsive and more strategic skills sector, and these benches are ready to make it a reality. What won't get us there, however, is this government burying its head in the sand over the very significant challenges that we face, and we cannot afford more dither and delay.
Thank you. And before calling Willie Rennie, could I remind all members who wish to speak in the debate, not trying to catch any particular person's eye, to please press the request to speak buttons now. Thank you. I call Willie Rennie. About 4 minutes, please, Mr Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Liberal Democrats have long argued that we need a massive investment in education, skills and retraining. The ability to retrain and learn new skills at every stage of life was more important than ever, even before the pandemic hit. Businesses need the tools to thrive and everyone should have access to good work. Problems like the climate emergency and the pandemic-related jobs crisis can often feel insurmountable. But a just transition to a net-zero economy can and should create opportunities and jobs. With investment and innovation backed up by retraining and upskilling opportunities, there is hope. We have the opportunity to rebuild and repurpose our economy towards climate-friendly industry and economy, pursuing and encouraging new green investments. If we get this right, Scotland could have the most highly skilled and adaptable workforce in Europe. In the Scottish budget deal last year, we secured £15 million in a special allocation for the North East to pay for skills, training, upskilling and business support in a region particularly under the pressure given its reliance on fossil fuels. That's how important we regard this agenda. It's why we made the case for a government-backed graduate internship programme, especially for SMEs, to get new talent into small and medium-sized businesses and to give that talent an important step on the employment ladder. I'm pleased the government is rolling that out. It's why we welcome the Young Person's Job Guarantee, because the scarring that we've seen in crises past must not be repeated this time. And I too want to thank Sandy Begbie for his leadership. It's why we welcomed the National Transition Training Fund, even though it had limited ambition. But as is often the case with this government, the rhetoric doesn't match the reality. The Minister and I had a bit of an exchange earlier this year on the government's failure to deliver its targets on the National Transition Training Fund. The target was 6,000, but only 3,000 were delivered by the end of March. The Minister blamed the pandemic and the furlough scheme, but that excuse doesn't wash because the target was set last October, right in the middle of the pandemic. Only half of an already cautious target was met for the period from October last year. Certainly.
Minister?
I don't know if he was listening when I made my opening remarks. I said, we're still waiting the final figures, but the indication is there were actually 9,000 starts to the National Transition Training Fund last year, so just thought that might be helpful.
Willie Rennie?
Well, it's curious what's happened with the deadlines and the targets for the National Transition Training Fund, because it's miraculously moved from March until July, an additional 4 months in which the Minister can try and get his numbers up to the target that he set. So that, in a kind of dangerous sleight of hand, just let me finish this point, in a dangerous sleight of hand, the Minister can suddenly confess or profess to have met his target. I think we should view this report with great suspicion. I'll take the Minister again.
I'm not sure if Mr Rennie's aware. A lot of that was delivered through, of course, our tertiary education system. He'll be aware that operates on an academic year basis rather than a financial year basis, so that is why the figures are as they are.
Willie Rennie.
But the Minister knew this last October. He's suddenly changing every set and criteria and target and deadline and numbers in order to suit his own argument. The truth is, the Minister failed to meet the target by March. That was revealed in a parliamentary answer at that time. It's very clear the Minister's failed. And rather than squirming away, trying to come up with various excuses as to why he's failed, he should just confess. Because he is squirming. He's holding his hands out. That's squirming if I've never seen it before. Yes, we'll take an
Daniel
intervention.
Johnson.
I'm grateful to the member for coming up. I wonder if he would agree with me whether quibbling about 1,000 or two here and there is totally irrelevant compared to the over 120,000 people we currently have unemployed or the 80,000 people who are on furlough when that scheme finished.
He makes a very good point. That's the point I made about the limited ambition of this whole programme. But even with that limited ambition, the Minister still failed to meet the target that he set only last October. These are his conditions, and he's failed to meet it. I think it's important that the government is honest, because we've got massive challenges in meeting the skills shortages right across a whole lot of sectors, from forestry to health, from early years education to the logistics sector. But the Minister is fiddling around with small numbers and making very little changes. That's why we're ending up with the skills crisis that we've got right now. So if the Minister's going to meet the ambition that is required of this country, to meet the ambition of young people, and in fact, people of all ages, that he's going to have to step up to the mark and start delivering for a change. Thank you.
Thank you. And we will now move to the open debate. And I call COCAP Stewart to be followed by Megan Gallagher. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to be speaking in this debate and to have the chance to reflect on the success of both the Young Persons Guarantee and the National Transitions Training Fund, just 1 year after their inception. As we steadily and conscientiously navigate our route out of recovery, it's crucial to remember that the social, educational and economic scars of this pandemic have disproportionately affected the lives of our young people in Scotland. Research funded by the Scottish Government and carried out by Young Scot, the Scottish Youth Parliament and Youth Link Scotland over the last year, and young people aged between 11 and 25 were given the opportunity to share their views in an open survey on the impact of COVID-19. From the thousands of responses, it was largely girls and young women, young people aged over 18, young people with a disability or long-term illness, and young carers who reported lower physical, mental well-being, lower satisfaction with educational arrangements, and lower levels of optimism about current and future employment prospects. In the same month that this COVID impact survey closed, the Scottish Government launched the Young Persons Guarantee, a commitment that every 16 to 24-year-old in Scotland will be given the chance to work or start an apprenticeship, attend further or higher education, or gain experience through specific training programmes or volunteering. With Fair Work remaining a key tenet of the SNP's economic plan, it is essential to create a labour market that values individual well-being and actively strives to remove the barriers faced by certain communities to find employment. And as such, while over 18,000 opportunities have already been created by the Young Persons Guarantee since 2020, including modern apprenticeships, graduate programmes, for example, I wholeheartedly welcome the additional £170 million pledged by this government, which will continue to support employers and providers to enable our young people to be equipped with the skills needed for Scotland's future. In addition, as part of building an inclusive and environmentally focused economy, enhancing the National Transitions Training Fund by a further £125 million will allow us to work towards our net zero ambitions and support those aged 25 and over to retrain and develop skills required to move into areas with the greatest potential for future growth and job opportunities. Joining thousands of people in Glasgow at the weekend in Marching for Climate Action, it is fantastic that employment initiatives will have a strong application towards the Climate Emergency Skill Action Plan and through the Green Jobs Workforce Academy, including aircraft decommissioning training for workers in the aerospace sector and upskilling and reskilling of individuals in the construction industry with a focus on energy efficiency. And I've seen that firsthand at the City of College in Kelvin. I'm just about to finish. After the success of its first year, which helped over 6,000 people enrol in a variety of training programmes, the National Transition Training Fund will continue for a second year, providing 20,000 training opportunities in sectors impacted by COVID-19, climate commitments and, of course, an unwanted EU exit. While progress has undoubtedly been made, there is no room for complacency. I am proud that this government continues to act with future generations in mind. And to paraphrase Fiona Hislop, my colleague, when she launched the Young Persons Guarantee, I want Scotland's young people to know that we are marching with you. We want you to be successful and we will do everything we can to give you the opportunities that you need.
Thank you. I now call on Megan Gallagher to be followed by David Torrens. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms Gallagher.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The pandemic is one of the biggest challenges facing young people across our United Kingdom. Young people have been detrimentally impacted as lockdowns and restrictions have affected their ability to work, study and plan for their futures. I can understand the worry that this must have caused to many who have just left school without any certainty of when life will return to normal. As we continue to manoeuvre out of this pandemic, we must turn our attention to young people in Scotland. They will be looking to us to ensure that we are creating jobs and providing opportunities to upskill. It is crucial that they have access to stable employment prospects once they have decided on their chosen career path. Although the pandemic has added to the pressures on the job market, we know that the Scottish Government was under pressure to make improvements when looking at providing opportunities for our young people. If we look at the SNP Scottish Government's record, we know that they have not done enough to provide our young people with the best opportunities once they leave school, higher or further education. For example, prior to the pandemic, the SNP broke their promise to achieve 30,000 modern apprenticeships per year by 2019. They have missed their target on employability fund starts, and the number of young people starting a modern apprenticeship has fallen 5 years in a row. Given the SNP has admitted themselves that the youth employment rate could rise to as high as 20%, their plan would only help 4% of our young people. This proves that the SNP do not know the ideas to create more opportunities for them. When we look at the rollout of the SNP's Young People's Guarantee and the national merit in the intention, it aims to bring employers, partners and young people together. But the delivery has been poor. Although 4,000 people have had training funded through the National Transition Training Fund, only 87% of those surveyed after completing the programme found a job. That's 13% of young people that will feel let down. I wonder if the Minister, in summing up, would acknowledge that we need to do more to help that 13% and make sure that this doesn't happen in future years as we continue with this programme. Turning to the SNP apprenticeship policy, which was announced at their party conference last year, the First Minister promised a £15 million programme that would pay businesses £5,000 for each apprenticeship they would take on. In principle, it is a good idea, as it supports young people into employment, as well as supporting businesses, as it has been difficult for them too. However, when you do the maths, and my colleague Pam Gossel did that during her opening remarks, only 3,000 young people will be supported by this scheme. Presiding Officer, the topic of today's debate is skills and opportunities to support recovery, and the Scottish Conservatives have the ambition to help and support young people, and some of these were outlined in our party's manifesto. Ideas such as unlimited. We know that the pandemic and climate change has created a demand in certain job sectors, and we must take advantage of that by promoting these vacancies and helping young people obtain work experience and jobs through apprenticeship programmes. It is simply not good enough to continue with the SNP's targets-based approach that ignores employers' needs. We would also look to support more women into apprenticeships. This is an area which is often overlooked, but we know that there is a gender gap, particularly in STEM-related career paths. What better than to use the discussions that we have all had over the last week during COP to bring more women into these sectors by apprenticeships and upskilling? Presiding Officer, to conclude, the SNP need to get a grip on these issues to make sure that our young people are provided with opportunities. If they don't act now to deal with the real issues facing our job sector, then sadly many young people will miss out on a life-changing opportunity which could have been offered by this Scottish Government. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now call David Torrance to be followed by Pauline McNeill. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr Torrance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The global COVID-19 pandemic has had an unprecedented impact, a full scale of which is still fully emerged. And in 2020, we saw the largest disruption to education and employment in recent history. School closures and more general disruption on learning has impacted greatly on education, development and well-being of children and young people, and particularly so for those who are vulnerable and marginalised. That says, I have been privileged to witness some truly astounding displays of resilience, determination and flexibility from young people in my constituency in the last 18 months, examples of which I am sure colleagues have also seen in their constituencies, the length and breadth of this country. The introduction of the National Transition Training Fund, along with the Young Persons Guarantee by the Scottish Government in 2020, in response to the economic impact of the coronavirus pandemic, was an important commitment to the future of employer workforce development and to those who need our support the most. By bringing together employers, partners and young people themselves, the aim of the Young Persons Guarantee was to connect 16 to 24-year-olds in Scotland to an opportunity, whether that be a job, apprenticeship, further or higher education, training programme or volunteering, was ambitious, progressive and forward-looking. I am delighted to see that the successful progression of this multifaceted programme has already created in excess of 18,000 opportunities for young people. Alongside the National Training Transition Fund, sought to tackle the rise in unemployment in adults aged 25+, by offering short, sharp training opportunities for people to learn in-demand skills, providing adults with tailored support to identify relevant training and employment opportunities, followed by funding training to match their individuals' needs. In Fife, I was pleased to see the initiative being warmly received with Fife College in partnership with Energy Skills Partnership, at the heart of delivering this invaluable support. A series of fully funded training courses have been made available to individuals aged over 25 who are either facing redundancy or who have been made redundant since March last year when the pandemic began. Fifers adversely affected by the pandemic can access a wide range of courses, including one of the most recent, Wiring Regulation Update and Upskilling Qualification and Electric Vehicle Charging, aimed to qualify electricians training in the energy sector. Engineering and construction sectors and health and safety qualifications are also on offer, including National Examination Board in Occupational Safety and Health, NEBOSH, General Certificate in the Institution of Occupational Safety and Health Management, IOSH. The purpose and design of these courses being allowed to tradespeople to upskill and help them move into roles with better potential for future growth and job retention. The renewable industry in Scotland is growing and offers great employment prospects for those who have required skills and knowledge. As we promote and explore the potential of Scotland's renewable energy source and its ability to meet our local and national heat, transport and electricity needs, it is clear and a highly skilled workforce will be fundamental to the success of the renewable industry.
Oliver Mundell.
Member for giving way, but given his party's been in government for 14 years, does he not feel we've missed the boat a bit when it comes to taking advantage of the opportunities the renewable sector offers?
David Torrance.
I thank the member for that question. Can I just say I'm slightly disappointed that the renewable sector and manufacturing jobs didn't come to us, and especially somebody who has a constituency who had by far been it. But UK government had a part to play in that. But it's also about training people for global jobs. I have several of my constituents who are now working in the renewable sector in maintenance, and they're working in Turkey, they're working in Italy, places like that. So they're out there in the world market and they're bringing back that income to the local economy and spend it in the local economy. Opportunities such as those being delivered by Fife College through the National Training Transition Fund are allowing tradesmen and women to retrain in renewable technology installation and maintenance and develop the required skills to transition into green jobs and a new future. Whilst it is, of course, important to recognise the progress that has been made, there remains work to be done. Efforts must and will continue to ensure the ambition and early success of these programmes are approved upon, with the addition of new and exciting opportunities. The increased investment of £70 million to support local partnerships or provide training and employer recruitment incentives, colleges to deliver around 5,000 more short industry-focused courses, the continued rollout of new school young force development workers and the new graduate internship scheme, increased volunteering capacity in the first sector programme is extremely welcome, as is the £20 million that has been made available through the second phase of the National Transition Training Fund in 2021-22. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we all know that our young people will have a key role to play as we deliver a better and fairer country and build upon our ambition for Scotland. We must learn from the work we have done so far and continue to work collaboratively to ensure that all young people can realise their full potential.
Thank you. I now call Polly McNeill to be followed by Claire Adamson. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms McNeill.
Thank you. The pandemic has caused a shock to the ambitions of young people, and we must urgently mitigate it if we do not want to leave an entire generation behind. The unemployment rate for young people is 1 in 10, and that's over double the rate of the rest of the population, with almost two-thirds of people lost their job due to the pandemic. We're under the age of 25. Young people have shouldered the burden of the pandemic disproportionately when it comes to employment. As I raised before, tens of thousands of young people shielded, gave up opportunities to basically protect themselves and the rest of the country, and they were not singled out for any attention. And that is something that still disappoints me deeply. As the Scottish Government's former adviser, Naomi Eidenstadt, pointed out a few years ago in the review of life chances of young people under the age or teenagers of 16 to 24. She said that choices of career, further training, employment and housing can be particularly problematic for young adults, but decisions at this stage can set the course for adulthood. And I've always believed that she's right when she said that. Of course I would, yeah.
Minister?
She mentions, I mean, she is quite right to express the concerns she has around the rate of youth unemployment. Those are concerns that I share, but she mentioned there was no response to that. Would she not recognise that the young person's guarantee might be felt to be a response to that reality?
Polly McNeill.
This is what I want to go on to talk about. Yes, the principle is the right response, but I think it was Michael Mara that pointed out earlier. It's the approach we take and the scale of that, and I do want to address that in some detail, Minister, because I am actually trying to be constructive about this, and I have gone through this website myself in some detail this afternoon, as if I was a young person looking to, and I find it's a very clunky website, and I'm going to address that, and I do hope, since you've asked me the question, you might take some of these points on board, because I don't really think we have a lot of time here, and I do acknowledge the work of Sandy Begbie and Graham Smith. And if I was in your shoes, which I'm not, but I really would put these people right at the leadership of this, because I do think we don't have a lot of time to get this back on track, given we do agree on the background of this, because there are 600,000 young adults in Scotland, a significant section of the working population. So, yes, I welcome the principle of the scheme. But I honestly think it lacks any serious attempt to directly engage with young people. And that example I gave is an example of that. I did specifically call on you, Minister, you were Minister at the time, to actually directly engage with young people who were shielding, because they were really struggling and many of them still are. A website is not enough. When you click on search for a job, you're presented with a keyword search. It already puts in keywords for you. But really, I thought it should be suggesting the areas which relies on a young person getting the knowledge, flagging up the jobs where there is growth. Where are the jobs for you? Where should they be looking? Because they don't know. They're 16 and 17 and 18 years old. It also includes volunteering roles. And whilst I do accept that volunteering is beneficial for young people, it's not a paid career, and it certainly is not necessarily a start on the career ladder, and the vast majority of young people can't afford to do it anyway. So I find that a bit of a strange one in the whole scheme of things. But I'd also like to hear the Minister's view on the guaranteed person, young person scheme that we will be delivering. We will not be delivering zero-hour contract positions, and that there is some expectation here that we're going to raise the living standards of young people too when they apply for jobs. Last year, the report of the Advisory Group on Economic Recovery stated that the scheme should offer secure employment for a period of at least 2 years to 16 to 25-year-olds paid at the living wage, with access to training, apprenticeships and the possibility of progression. But despite the scheme being launched in November 2020, the Scottish Government has confirmed that they have still set no targets or key performance indicators, meaning that there is still no way to measure the success or the impact of the scheme. Having promised 130,000 green jobs by 2020, we are significantly behind, with only 21,000 jobs confirmed. And the Green Jobs Workforce Academy announced in August this year, it's not really clear how many jobs are actually being offered under this part of it. The link provided on the Academy's website comes up with around about 900 jobs. And again, I mean, I saw this for myself this afternoon. It's the scale of the response. As a glass, I'll finish on this point. Pretending to be a Glasgow young person, there were about 500 jobs thrown up in the scheme. I think that's really, really significantly low where we intend to be. I hope we can make significant improvements on the scheme, Minister, and I hope you will listen to what I've said. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Claire Adamson to be followed by Tess White. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you. I'm enjoying the debate this afternoon. Indeed, I've kind of changed what I was going to talk about initially, calling on my own experience as an IT professional. And it's really to follow up on what my colleague Emma Harper was indicating, is that there's lots of really, really good work going on out there. And I think we're in real danger of forgetting that and seeing how innovative Scotland is in responding to things like the IT skills gap, that we can talk down the industry and maybe put people off. I should declare... Yes, I'll take it now.
Michael Mara.
I mean, would the member not recognise then the Logan Review that was published by this government, by Mark Logan's own work, that recognised the huge skills gaps that there were in the industry, and the potential for growth, and actually the necessity for growth? Speak to employers in my constituency who tell me software engineers are like hen's teeth.
Claire Adamson.
Absolutely, and I declare an interest as still being a member of the British Computer Society, but it's not just in Scotland, it's everywhere. There's shortages in this area, and that's why we should be encouraging initiatives like Dress Code, which is a not-for-profit charity started by a computing teacher in Scotland that encourages young women to take up computing in school and promotes coding in all sorts of areas, games design, but also in cyber security. It's really, in fact, I believe they're running a competition for a poster to encourage more women to take part in it. No, I've taken one intervention. I've only got 4 minutes, sorry. And these initiatives are really making a difference to encouraging people to come forward. And also, one of the things I'm going to talk about, if I get back to my speech I planned to do this afternoon, was the way our educational establishments work with our communities and work in partnership with people across Scotland to encourage people to take part in education. And one of those is the Open University and its Coding Skills Plus programme. Now, they responded to the COVID pandemic, and there's 100 opportunities that were made available to £1 million Digital Start Fund that was managed by Skills Development Scotland. And it was all about taking on people who had been furloughed or made redundant as a result of COVID and training them 13 weeks intense training in IT to give them the skills they needed to take up these very productive, very highly paid jobs that we want in Scotland. And I just feel that we have to do that and also point people to Scotland. Scotland is doing an incredible amount of work in terms of encouraging people into IT in Scotland and presenting that. And we've so much to be thankful for in terms of the success of our games industry, the success of Abertay University and other universities that have taken up the games industry and are teaching people to code in it. Sorry, I'm not going to take another intervention. And this is where I wanted to be today, because I really wanted to talk about coming back to my own constituency and the great work that's been done there with foundation apprenticeships. Emma Pritley had the joy of visiting with the Deputy First Minister a few years ago, Braidhurst High School, and they've really embedded that partnership with New College Lanarkshire. And New College Lanarkshire is an incredible college, exemplified by the success in the World Skills competitions, where they're taking young people each and every year to competitions within Britain and then to the wider world, exemplifying all the training that they are doing, skilling young people and being an absolute exemplar of how this can work to encourage young people to take up apprenticeships that are so, so important going forward. And I just think that, you know, we're, the Young Persons Guarantee is such a great development, and we can't forget just how important some of those initiatives have been in encouraging young people, in giving people confidence that they don't need to go to college or university, albeit that's a brilliant way for them to go forward. But there are opportunities through foundation apprenticeships and through working and gaining those skills while they're working. But please, please, can we also have fair work? Please, no more discrimination against age because of young people are paid less minimum wage. And please, can we also put an end to unfair work trials that are unpaid for our young people going forward? Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. I now call Tess White to be followed by Paul McLennan. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms. White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The challenges facing our young people as a result of the current public health crisis cannot be overstated, with implications for social, economic and health-related outcomes. Against this background, the ambition for the Young Persons Guarantee was bold, and I too thank Sandy Begbie. Within 2 years of its introduction, every 16 to 24-year-old in Scotland will either be in paid employment, on an apprenticeship or training programme, enrolled in education or engaged in formal volunteering. Key to the success of the guarantee in its design and the pace of implementation is the think tank Our Scottish Future argues that job creation through the scheme is taking second place to several rounds of consultation and governance design. Overall, it identifies a disconnect between ambition, incentivisation and opportunity creation. We know, however, that time is of the essence. Figures published in September this year show there are around 8,300 more unemployed young people than there were pre-pandemic, a rise of 2.7%. And yet the Minister confirmed earlier this year that the Scottish Government has not set targets. You might say about 9,000 and you come up with a target, but you haven't set targets for the Young Persons Guarantee. Meanwhile, the overarching key performance indicator is a return to pre-pandemic levels of unemployment by the end of this parliamentary terms. Now, I might take an intervention at some point when you've sorted out your clunky website and something that's easier to navigate, but not now. So unemployment by the end of this parliamentary term and 5 years from now. Presiding Officer, it is of course critical that we assess the impact of COVID-19 on the opportunities available to young people. But the absence of opportunities cannot be blamed on the pandemic alone. Labour market statistics for Scotland show that the employment rate for 16 to 24-year-olds has been decreasing since July 2018, which suggests at least some of the underlying drivers are systemic. Ensuring that Scotland's young people have the right training and skills is key to long-term attachment to the labour market. Apprenticeships in particular can help to provide the next generation of workers with the skills our economy needs. Yet modern apprenticeship starts for the 16 to 19-year-olds have fallen every year since 2014. We know from the most recent Scottish Employer Skills Survey that more than a fifth of all vacancies were skill shortage vacancies. Employers couldn't fill them because applicants simply didn't have the skill set, knowledge or experience to do the role. And it's not just software engineers. Furthermore, the OECD's 2020 report on skills in Scotland emphasised that improvements could be made to increase the responsiveness, quality and flexibility of the apprenticeship system. It's good to hear you say, Minister, you are heeding the calls from organisations like CBI Scotland and the Scottish Conservatives, who have always advocated strongly for a demand-led approach which would enable businesses to create apprentice places based on their specific needs. This is the skills revolution that Scotland needs. And finally, it's undoubtedly true that the past 18 months have been incredibly challenging, but there is scope here to create a skilled workforce of young people that can meet the emerging needs of the economy as it recovers. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Martin Whitfield. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr. McLennan.
Presiding Officer, thank you for the opportunity to speak in this debate this afternoon. Only last week I arranged a meeting with Skills Development Scotland, the DWP, and East London Works to look at our skills and employability strategy. At that meeting, we discussed the situation in East Lothian. We talked about the sectors that have been impacted by Brexit. In hospitality, many businesses aren't working on full capacity. In farming, many fruit farmers are telling me that they won't be planting fruit next year as they have no one to pick the fruit. And in care, all our providers are struggling to recruit. At that same meeting, I heard about our unemployment rate, which is 5.8%, which is higher than the national rate of 4.8%. Unemployment rate for 16 to 24-year-olds is higher than the national rate of 12.4%. But for context, and I hope our Tory colleagues listen to this, the UK rate for 16 to 24-year-olds unemployment rate is 17%. So I'm not going to take any lessons for Tories on youth unemployment. The claimant count for East Lothian in September was 2,435, which is 38% higher than the pre-pandemic levels in February 2021. Between the 1st of July and 26th of October 2021, there was 2,421 job postings advertised across East Lothian. So we can see higher claimant counts with higher job postings. The challenge is, how do we work on these stats and marry these stats? I want to focus on the young person's guarantee in this speech. We need to make it as easy as possible for young people to understand their learning and career choices at the earliest stage and provide long-term person-centred support for the young person who this is most is key. I know Skills Development Scotland are leading on collaborative system-wide review into careers information, advice, and we've got Careers Week next week, and guidance to bring together reviews and experiences of young people, parents, employers, teachers and experts. In addition, Skills Development Scotland have held a series of mapping workshops with the Department of Work and Pensions, local authorities and the third sector on behalf of the Scottish Government, looking at the interaction points and handovers between SDS, DWP and local authorities, and also, importantly, third sector employability provision for young people. The review of the senior phase will help us better align education provision at all levels with the future economic strategy for Scotland with the needs of employers. The implementation of DYW school coordinators in every secondary school in Scotland is also key, with engagement partners looking to increase opportunities for work-based learning for pupils and support their access to education, work and in training. We've heard discussions about apprenticeships, and they play a crucial role with developed pathway apprenticeships and confirmed funding that the Minister mentioned for foundation and graduate apprenticeships. The work of the Enterprise and Skills Strategic Board is also important for this work, as well as the Scottish Funding Council, Skills Development Scotland and enterprise agencies. The Scottish Government, UK Government and local authorities all work together, and I've seen this in East Lothian, to ensure alignment between the Kickstart programme and the Young Person's Guarantee. I'm having quarterly meetings in East Lothian to ensure we all work closer together. Local, tailored approaches are key as we tackle this issue. In supporting those who need it most, we need to gain a better understanding of the sectors that support groups of young people who can face barriers and why they face due to inequality, which we know has been exacerbated due to the pandemic. Local partnerships with additional funding for recruitment initiatives to support young people into jobs and apprenticeships is key. Some of the hardest hit sectors are leisure, tourism, hospitality and care, where traditionally young people, people from minority ethnic backgrounds and women have secured jobs. Opportunities and roles within the health and social care sector could be used to support young people into employment. There are opportunities to develop local and sector-based initiatives, such as hospitality academies. In rural economies, the Growing Rural Talent Programme allows opportunities to young people to develop relevant skills and knowledge of both the forestry and agricultural sectors, while still at school as part of the pathway to a range of opportunities post-school. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, a highly skilled, motivated young workforce is key to meeting the challenges of Brexit and COVID recovery. Let's all play our part in supporting this agenda and develop our young people as best we can.
Thank you. I now call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Emma Harper. Around 4 minutes, please, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to Deputy Presiding Officer. In the short time that I have, I would like to concentrate on the Young Persons Guarantee of this afternoon's debate. The Young Persons Guarantee, the commitment to bring together employers, partners and young people. It aims to connect every 16 to 24-year-old in Scotland to an opportunity. But what is that opportunity? It could be a job, apprenticeship, further or higher education, training programme, or indeed from the scant evidence available, more likely to be a volunteering opportunity. And as we emerge from the pandemic, there is a real and present danger that the COVID generation of 18 to 25-year-olds coming through this crisis are set at a permanent disadvantage compared to their elder peers. We have a group of young people with a lost 18 months of developing with the experiences those that went before had, a lost 18 months of extending those friendship circles that are so important going forward, a lost 18 months of growing up with the support that existed to those who went before. They are our COVID generation, a generation promised that they will have an opportunity. Despite the scheme being launched in November 2020, the Scottish Government has confirmed that they have still set no targets, no key performance indicators for their Young Persons Guarantee, meaning there is no way to measure the success or indeed the impact of the scheme. In June this year, responding to a written question... Please, yeah.
Minister?
I'm sure he wouldn't want to mislead the Parliament. KPIs have, in fact, been published. I'm happy to send them to him.
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful for that intervention because indeed in June this year, in a written response, Mr Hepburn, you said that we have not set targets for guarantee. But it is right that in July 2021, you published an implementation progress report, which states work continues to develop the measurement and evaluation framework, which will underpin our understanding of how the Young Persons Guarantee is working for young people. That very same report highlights the key risks and mitigations. And let me give you one example. The potential risk is stated as colleges and universities may be unable to deliver additional training and opportunities due to possible lack of resource. The mitigation that's highlighted in it is one, regular engagement with further and higher education partners. Two, regular engagement with students and their representative organisations. Could I humbly suggest that if additional training and opportunities are undeliverable because of resources, the answer is probably not engagement, but better resources. Your written answer went on to say, as part of this process, we are developing a set of key performance indicators that will help us understand the cumulative impact of the guarantee. These are due to be finalised in the summer of 2021. A scheme which shows more hope than delivery. The report provides updates on progress made against the initial recommendations for the guarantee, and out of the 28 initial recommendations, a third are tracked. As work commenced, further development required. So with so many young people unemployed and a scheme being in place for over a year, we can and should do more. Looking at the unemployment figures from June to August 2021, the unemployment rate for young people was as high as 10.1%. It's over double the national average of 4.4%. We can and should do more. So is there an assurance that zero-hour contracts will not be the opportunity? That fair work will lie at the heart of the opportunity? And I'm quite happy to give my last 10 seconds if the Minister would like to respond to that.
Minister.
The member will know that we have high aspirations for fair work and we will always seek to advance fair work. If we had, of course, some powers over employment law, we could do more.
Martin Whitfield.
High aspiration can only be measured if you know what you are going to measure it against. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I now call Emma Harper, who will be the last speaker in the open debate. Around 4 minutes, please, Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak today and I welcome the contributions so far this afternoon and thank Michael Marra for taking my intervention earlier. I didn't actually thank him earlier when he took my intervention. The financial, social, physical and mental health challenges people have across Scotland have faced during COVID-19 pandemic have been extremely difficult. And Scotland's young people have felt the effects of the pandemic particularly hard. The pandemic has also had a negative impact on people in sectors such as hospitality and tourism. It's hugely important in Dumfries and Galloway and the Scottish borders. Presiding officer, to alleviate the pandemic's impact, young people looking to enter the workforce across Scotland have benefited from £70 million of investment from the Scottish Government through the Young Persons Guarantee. It offers every 16 to 24-year-old in Scotland the opportunity of a job, apprenticeship, further or higher education, training programme or volunteering opportunity. And since it was officially launched in November 2020, funding has been committed to create up to 18,000 training, job and apprenticeship opportunities for young people. It includes £45 million for local partnerships to provide training and employer recruitment incentives, and £13.5 million for colleges, universities and the Scottish Funding Council to provide industry-focused courses supporting up to 5,000 young people and employment support for 500 recent graduates. This funding has allowed local employers such as Jas P. Wilson, BSW Timber, Alpha Solway and DuPont Teijin in Dumfries and Galloway to increase their number of modern apprenticeship places. I visited all of these employers recently, and previously I want to thank them all for all the work that they do and for supporting our next generation workforce. However, I have been contacted by local manufacturers, including Alpha Solway, who I visited 2 weeks ago, who feel that more work could be carried out to promote manufacturing as a positive career destination. So I'd therefore like to ask the Minister to ensure that Skills Development Scotland and the Scottish Government officials work with manufacturing firms to ensure young people are aware of the benefits of a career in Scottish manufacturing. This will also help improve the resilience of our local manufacturing supply chains. Presiding officer, I also welcome the £25 million National Transition Training Fund. It has already helped 10,000 people, including 312 young folks across Dumfries and Galloway, to develop the skills required to move into sectors with the greatest potential for future growth. I have been contacted by the National Farmers Union recently, though, who have highlighted the need for rural skills to be the focus of the fund, as well as for agriculture and rural skills to be highlighted as positive destinations for people of all ages, but particularly for our young people. NFU Scotland believe that schools and career advisers don't promote the farming and food production sector, and that it is often perceived as a last resort for less able or less academic young people. The farming sector requires an efficient, effective and user-friendly education and skills system that is responsive to the sector's current and future needs. And this is particularly important as agriculture is going to play a huge part in tackling the climate emergency. I therefore support all initiatives to ensure a professional rural workforce equipped with the necessary skills and knowledge. Previously, I met with George Jimison, Policy Officer with NFU Scotland, about NFU's report and recommendations on how to improve the rural workforce, which is increasingly ageing. I have written to the Rural Secretary about how these recommendations from NFU can be taken forward, but would be grateful if the Minister would agree to meet with George Jimison and I to discuss this matter future. Presiding officer, in closing, I want to again welcome this debate and the steps which have been taken by the Scottish Government to support those who have suffered most during the pandemic, and again highlight my asks for manufacturing and rural skills.
Thank you. And we now move to closing point of order, Ms McLennan.
Just for clarity, in my speech, obviously I mentioned a meeting with the DWP, East Lothian Works and so on. I just wanted to point out that I'm a serving councillor and that's on my register of interest. Even though the meeting was on MSP, I want to just mention that for clarity, and if that can be recorded, please.
Thank you, Mr McLennan. That will now be on the record. So we now move to closing speeches, and I call on Daniel Johnson. Around 6 minutes, please, Mr Johnson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. This afternoon, I think we've been trying to do something that is a little complicated, and certainly complicated to do in 90 minutes, and that is address two big and fundamental issues. First of all, is our skills and apprenticeship system up to the job of addressing the skills issues thrown up by COVID? And the second issue is whether or not it is adequately meeting the needs of Scotland in the future. That is a complicated thing to do, but we don't actually have the luxury of picking those issues off one by one. I think my frustration through this debate from both the government benches and the SNP backbenches is that they've essentially been arguing that because
we have the Young Persons Guarantee, because we have the National Transition Training Fund, no further questions should be asked. But it is absolutely relevant, and indeed I think important, that we question whether or not those schemes are up to the job, and in terms of both the urgency of the task at hand and indeed the scale of the problem. That is very much, I think, the argument that my colleague Pauline McNeill was setting out. It's not to say that those things aren't doing work, but are they doing enough work? And the second point, I think, very well outlined by my colleague Michael Mara, is questioning whether or not the skills system is actually delivering on the fundamental skills needs, such as digital skills, such as zero-carbon skills, that our economy doesn't just need for the future, but relies on. And indeed, my frustration in some ways is summed up by the exchange between Michael Mara and Claire Adamson, because absolutely, there are some really great things going on in terms of helping young people into coding. But the fundamental is this, is that since 2008, the number of computer science teachers in our schools has dropped by a quarter. You just simply cannot deliver the digital skills we need if we can't guarantee, as Michael Mara was calling for, a higher computer science class in every secondary school. Those young people simply can't have the skills they need if those subjects aren't being delivered in those schools. And I'll give way to my friend, Claire Adams.
Claire Adams.
Thank you. And as a colleague on the last Education Skills Committee, I know Mr Johnson, when we did our STEM inquiry, will understand that many of the people who are trained in computing science and teachers who become trained go on and take up jobs in that area. And that's one of the difficulties in recruiting computing teachers. But would you also recognise that the partnerships with the colleges give an opportunity for that curriculum element to be delivered through our colleges, through foundation apprenticeships, through young people attending the colleges? And that's all about what the Developing the Young Workforce programme was about.
Daniel Johnson, I'll give you a bit of time.
Thank you very much. I thank Claire Adams for that intervention, but in a sense, you acknowledging the problem doesn't make it go away. And indeed, it's taken to this point to hear an acknowledgement of that fundamental problem from the SNP benches. You know, it's not to say that there aren't people finding jobs in this area, that there aren't good schemes, but that the fundamental lack of teachers is the sort of thing that, frankly, the government is simply putting its head in the sand. And I think, you know, furthermore, if we look at the more urgent and pressing problems from COVID, we are in a different situation than we were expecting to. I think many of us thought we would be facing a very large unemployment crisis. That hasn't occurred, but there are labour shortages. And indeed, there were 80,000 people on furlough when that scheme came to an end. And the question is, are those responses up to the job of reskilling the people that need to? Because it is possible to have both labour shortages and people unable to go into those jobs, unable to reskill. And the simple maths is this, is that between the Young Persons Guarantee and the National Transition Fund, only 44,000 opportunities are even going to be aimed to be achieved, let alone what is achieved. Now, there was a rather odd quibble going on between Willie Rennie and the Minister as to whether it was 3,000, 7,000, 9,000. That is irrelevant. The relevant point is that the response up to the scale of that challenge. And the scale of the challenge is measured not in thousands of opportunities, thousands of places, but in the hundreds of thousands of people that are currently unemployed. And we need to tackle that. And I thought Martin Whitfield's contribution was... I'd be glad.
Willie Rennie?
Of course, the member is right. The scale of the challenge, it needs to be met. But surely we've got to measure the government on its performance, on the targets that it's met, if we're going to trust its overall strategy and objectives.
Daniel Johnson?
In terms of my quibbling, maybe I should have been clear. I wasn't quibbling with my colleague that sits behind me, but more with the quibbling that was coming from the government benches, because he's absolutely right. Is what we're, in terms of the precise number is irrelevant, but are those strategic targets right? Is the scale of the intervention appropriate to the scale of the challenge? And on that, I think the numbers tell us a much more gloomy picture than perhaps the Minister was wanting to paint. I mean, ultimately, we need urgency and flexibility. We can't simply have a kind of long-drawn-out engagement processes when we're met with a lack of resource to deliver the points, as my colleague Martin Whitfield. And quite simply, I think the government's approach has been found wanting. But by the same token, I think we must, and I think there was a fair challenge from some of the benches, that we cannot simply paint a complete picture of doom and gloom. There are real strengths in the apprenticeship system. I think we've seen a system develop that actually has confidence of much of industry. That we have a system, in contrast with other parts of the United Kingdom, which is actually fundamentally grounded in work and in jobs. And so to that point, I have to say I too shared the questions about what the Conservative benches meant by a demand-led system. I mean, fundamentally, we have a system that's driven by work. Where I think there is criticism, I think we should focus our critique because is around the flexibility of that system. Too many employers talk to me about the fact that they're essentially they have to take the modern apprenticeship frameworks as they stand, that you can't take it piecemeal, that it's inflexible to short-term need. Likewise, many employers will point to me, including most notably the retail industry, about the level of benefit they get simply does not match what they are levied through the apprenticeship levy. Only 2% of modern apprenticeships are in retail, and they've seen a 44% in retail apprenticeships. So I think the government has to address those issues, which is not to say that the system is completely flawed, but if we're going to improve the system, we have to recognise the flaws.
Mr Johnson, I have been generous. Yes.
I will close there. We need flexibility, urgency and a response that matches the scale of the issue. Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And I now call on Oliver Mundell. Around 7 minutes, please, Mr Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This has been a wide-ranging and important debate, but I cannot help but feel it's a topic where we're good at talking, but not at doing. My colleague, Pam Gosol, quoted Confucius at the start of this debate, and whilst I'm not normally into deep words of wisdom, I do think that he's right, because it's almost always what we do that matters. And after 14 years under SNP rule, it's not entirely clear what progress has been made. I can't see any evidence of the parity of esteem for skill-based education that is so often pronounced. In an SNP Scotland, it is school and university-based education that are the default, automatic now for many. In direct contrast, we now find in an SNP Scotland, it is a struggle to access training for real jobs and opportunities where identified shortages exist. This is not an accident. It has come about as a direct result of choices taken in ministerial corridors. We do not have a well-balanced system, nor one that is working well. And behind this inconvenient truth, as we've heard time and time again today in our debate, is a lack of ambition. Whilst, to be fair, many nice-sounding initiatives have been announced, it's not entirely clear that they meet the scale of the challenge we face. Many colleagues across the chamber have covered in their own contributions why some of these schemes are not delivering what was promised and why they are not as good in reality as they are when they're announced in this chamber. I do not wish to go back over these points, but they simply serve to reinforce my own view that the government are falling short. The pandemic and its shocks and the shocks that it sent through our society and our economy should be the wake-up call we need to change our approach to skills and training. Our task in building that better would, of course, have been easier if we were in a better position pre the pandemic. But this is an area where there's been no real drive or sense of purpose for over a decade. You only have to look at how our college sector has been funded and supported to understand how little priority skills and training have been given. In a country serious about vocational education, ministers would be looking to expand access to college places, to turbocharge the whole sector financially, and to enable colleges to provide many more modular courses. Instead, colleges continue to be the poor relation, undervalued and underutilised. Presiding Officer, we need to create a system that is dynamic and nimble and that adapts to the changing needs of our economy. But most importantly, we need skills, training and apprenticeship opportunities that work for people and which are available to them when they need them. That's why, on this side of the chamber, we support a demand-led approach to apprenticeships. We believe this would make them more attractive for employers and therefore create more opportunities for employees. That's not about setting arbitrary targets. It's about reaching out to businesses, business groups, business representatives and opening up the opportunity to create as many new apprenticeships as possible. As a number of colleagues have touched on, I would be keen to hear the Minister's view on this idea, and the fact that the SNP are missing their own targets doesn't mean that there isn't more capacity to create more apprenticeships and that employers aren't willing to do more. And I think Daniel Johnston is right to look at some of the processes around taking on and training apprentices too, because that is often too complicated, particularly for smaller businesses. And Emma Harper mentions the farming sector. I too met with George Jameson recently, and there is a concern within the rural sectors, which are often under a lot of pressure, that people don't have the time and resource to support apprenticeships, even though they would like to. So I think it's worth looking at what we do there. Presiding Officer, as I've said already, we need a change in approach. But all we have in the face of the urgent challenge that lies before us is an SNP government who talk big on skills but deliver little. An SNP government who believe that making announcements is the same thing as delivering change. An SNP government who are out of big ideas and instead focus on lots of small schemes and small pots of money and hope that no one's going to notice that there's no real strategy underpinning their direction. Rather than patting themselves on the back, ministers urgently need to wake up to the scale of the challenge facing our economy, our society and individuals across Scotland. The harsh reality is that many of the stubborn skill shortages highlighted today are created here in Scotland by the actions or lack of actions taken here in this Parliament and at the heart of the Scottish Government. Whilst the pandemic has exposed many weaknesses and increased the scale of the challenge, we cannot and should not accept that these things weren't a problem before COVID-19. However, all is not lost. We have everything we need to succeed. We have an education sector, a workforce and employers all ready to go. The only question is whether the government is ready to move from words to action and recognise for the first time the scale of the challenge that faces the people of Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. I call on Jamie Hepburn to wind up. Minister, until 5 p.m.
Thank you very much, President Officer. Can I begin by thanking those who have contributed to today's debate. I think what we have heard today, and it may not have always been apparent through some of the rhetoric that's been deployed, is actually a great degree of agreement in terms of the approach that we need to take in gearing our skills system towards the end of better supporting people to where the opportunities lie. And the Young Persons Guarantee, National Transition Training Fund, I don't actually have the clock, but after less than a minute, why not?
Oliver Mundell.
I thank the Minister for giving way. He says that there's a wide degree of consensus. Did he hear the consensus across this chamber that none of the actions the Scottish Government are taking go far enough or fast enough to meet the challenge?
Minister.
Well, I certainly heard Oliver Mundell say that. Whether that represents consensus is another matter, but I'll develop the point I was going on to make, because I do recognise, of course, there's not complete agreement in terms of the approach that's been taken. But I want to say to Daniel Johnson, because he was seeming to suggest that there's no cognizance, no recognition that more has to be done or that different things need to be deployed. I recognise that has to be the case. I suppose the fundamental question, and I'm maybe paraphrasing it, that he posed is effectively, is our skills system up to the challenge that I've just posed? Well, the first thing I would reflect, and again, here's some consensus for Mr. Mundell. I very much agree with his point about the strong foundations of our education system. I also agree with Mr. Johnson about the strengths of our modern apprenticeship system. But of course, we must be ever more responsive to the challenges we face. We must ensure that our skills system is ever better geared towards the ends that we have to see in terms of ensuring that we support people to where the opportunities lie. That is the direction I want our skills system to move in. It's laid out in our Future Skills Action Plan, so there's probably more agreement in the terms of what we've discussed today than might otherwise have been felt to be the case. Of course, yes.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm grateful. I was actually questioning the skills system a little less fundamentally than that. I think fundamentally what I was saying was that there was a lack of analysis coming forward for the government of what had worked and critically what hadn't worked in terms of that response in terms of the National Transition Training Fund and the jobs guarantee. I mean, what does he think has worked, but critically what hasn't worked and what should be improved upon as we go forward?
Minister.
Well, what I can say to Mr Johnson, I agree with him. We must always be willing to prosecute the schemes that we've put in place to see what has worked, and that's something I'm committed to doing. So there will be an assessment of the Young Persons Guarantee, there will be an assessment of the National Transition Training Fund, and that will be available for Parliament to look at and to assess. I want to turn to some of the points that have been made over the course of the debate, and I'll start off with Mr Rennie's contribution. I have to say he thought I was squirming. He rather overestimates the impact his words and rhetoric have on me, just to put it in its full context. But I did agree, and again, there's some more agreement for you. I did agree with the point that he made about the need to focus on sectors where we have skills needs through the National Transition Training Fund. And across the range of the over 30 programmes we have this year, I would absolutely argue that that is where we are very much geared towards. Michael Mara mentioned the requirement to have a very concerted focus on the digital sector. This year two of the National Transition Training Fund, we have our Digital Start Fund, which will support those who are unemployed or on low incomes to gain advanced digital skills, our Digital Reskilling Pipeline, our Digital Skills Catalyst Fund, Code Your Future, looking at other sectors, in early learning and childcare, Taster programme, tourism and hospitality, talent development programme, an introduction to adult social care, the Open University Adult Social Care Boost, aerospace, a diversification, aircraft decommissioning, work for aviation, work in the construction sector, work for the forestry sector, and indeed for the screen sector, as well as others. So hopefully that is an indication that we have a programme that's geared towards the very end that Mr Rennie was talking about. And of course, I give way to Mr Mann.
Michael
Mara. I appreciate the Minister giving way. On the point of digital skills and the need to enhance it, does he believe that in every high school in Scotland, higher computing should be available, taught by a qualified teacher?
Yeah. Minister.
Well, of course, we have in common, and this goes back to the crux of the challenge we face, where we have digital shortage, where we face digital challenges, that affects every single sector, the rise in people with digital skills. And unfortunately, the teaching profession has been subject to that challenge as well. What I can say to Mr Mara, of course, is that we put in additional support to support career changers from the digital sector into STEM subjects. And that is something I would certainly be encouraging people to avail themselves of. I want to talk about apprenticeships and, in particular, the comments of the Conservative members. I have to say, Pam Gosol wasn't so much Confucius, but confused on these matters as far as I was concerned, as indeed was Megan Gallagher when she referred to our missing our 2019 target of 30,000 apprenticeships. Our 2019 target was actually 27,000 apprenticeships, and we delivered 27,270. And Tess White's suggestion that the numbers have been falling year on year is fundamentally flawed. In 2016-17, we saw 26,262 starts, 2017-18, 27,145, 2018-19, 27,270, 2019-20, 27,875. She might have been getting confused and thinking about the experience south of the border under her party's governance, where in the same equivalent period of time there was an 172,400 decline in the number of apprenticeship starts, a 35% decline by comparison to an increase of 6% here in Scotland. Why not?
Rachel Hamilton.
Minister, I was hoping that you, in your closing, that you would address the issue of rural skills as addressed by Emma Harper. And I recently asked the government a question about how many female butchers there are in Scotland, and the answer is 15 to 20. 15 to 20. And so how does that demonstrate that this Scottish government is addressing both the gender skills gap and the overall skills gap?
Minister.
What I can say to Ms Hamilton is that I recognise across a range of frameworks the gender segregation we see in apprenticeships is not acceptable, and that's why Skills Development Scotland has
a programme working to ensure that we see improvement in that regard. That's not restricted just to the area she has spoken of, but to others as well. And having mentioned Emma Harper, I suppose I could mention quickly, I'll be very delighted to meet with her to discuss some of the issues she's raised in relation to the rural workforce. Of course, we have our Rural Skills Action Plan working towards that end. Returning to apprenticeships more widely, I'm genuinely perplexed as to the Conservative position that somehow the figures we saw last year were anything other than as a reality, the impact of COVID-19. I've literally just set out the figures year and year before. The one factor we had last year that was different from the years before was COVID-19. And what we can see is a further vivid demonstration of that reality is that the figures out this morning, hot off the press today, show that by the end of quarter two this year, we had 11,104 modern apprenticeship starts, which is an increase of 7,471 by the period last year. That is a very clear demonstration of the impact of COVID-19. I want to turn to Pauline McNeill. She asked me to listen to what she has said. I will be very happy to do that. She made some practical remarks around the website. I'm happy to take that away. I can't promise to fix it myself, Ms White, but I'll certainly take it away and see if some people who can have a look at it. But she mentioned that leadership should continue to be invested in people like Sandy Begbie. I'm very happy to tell her Sandy Begbie remains the chair of the implementation group of the Young Persons Guarantee, and he is the chair of Developing Young Workforce Employers groups. He's very much involved and very much leading in that regard. To turn to Mr Whitfield's remarks, again, I thought they were a bit confusing. He seemed very concerned by the terms of an answer I had previously provided him with. He talked about the need to establish KPIs and support for the tertiary sector. I would respectfully suggest to Mr Whitfield that the answer I gave at a fixed point in time doesn't represent the end of the story, and actually there are developments subsequent to that. So I've already made the point about KPIs now being published in a second. And in terms of his remarks around the need to support the tertiary education sector in the area of the Young Persons Guarantee, I'm happy to say that this year we invested a further £10 million to create 5,000 additional opportunities in the college sector. One example is a partnership between Edinburgh College and NHS Lothian to create the health care skills boost. Edinburgh College, of course, covers part of the area that Mr Whitfield represents, so I would have thought he might have known about that programme and some of the investment we've made. And we've also allocated £3.5 million for a graduate talent internship programme. I'll give way to him very briefly.
Very briefly.
Very grateful, very grateful, Presiding Officer. So with regard to the Young Persons Guarantee, what will success look like for any disability young person?
In winding up, Minister.
Well, at its core, it will be participation in the Young Persons Guarantee. It will be ensuring that they get to take part in the programme just as any other person. So that's the very simple and straightforward answer to what was a very simple and straightforward question. Can I conclude by saying I do welcome we have had the debate. I would again say I think that through the rhetoric that's been deployed, I actually do believe that there's more agreement amongst us than anyone watching might come to conclude. I want to make the point again, though, I want a skills system that is responsive to economic and societal need. It has to be through the process of technological change that Michael Mara spoke of, through some of the challenges we're seeing in securing labour through the withdrawal from EU, some of the changes to our sectors, responding to the imperative of reacting to the environmental crisis. We have to make sure that skills system is geared towards that. We have to make sure that no one's left behind. The Young Persons Guarantee and the National Transition Training Fund are geared towards that end. I am committed to delivering that type of skills system. That's what I will focus on. That's what this government will focus on.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on skills and opportunities to support recovery, Young Persons Guarantee and National Training Transition Fund 1 year on. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of a Parliamentary Bureau motion. I ask George Adam to move motion 2048 on approval of an SSI. And I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moved.
Thank you. Thank you. I now call on Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wish to oppose SSI 2021/349 on the introduction of vaccine passports. This is being considered by this Parliament nearly 6 weeks after this instrument became law. We have, on this side of the chamber, consistently opposed compulsory vaccine passports in the manner they have been brought in by the Scottish Government, and nothing that has happened in the last 6 weeks has persuaded us that our position should change. This is a policy for which no evidence base has ever existed or been presented to us. At the COVID-19 Recovery Committee last week, as we heard earlier in the chamber, the Deputy First Minister had to accept that the evidence that this policy was working does not exist. And yet the Scottish Government are today, are talking about extending it still further. I'll give way to Mr. Mason.
John Mason.
I thank Mr. Fraser for giving way, but I mean, would he accept that? I think some of the Deputy First Minister's words have been twisted somewhat. It is impossible with any action, including hand washing, to link that to an exact result.
Murdo Fraser.
Presiding Officer, if we're being asked to bring in a policy that brings in substantial restrictions on the behaviour of individuals and is having a very substantial negative impact on businesses, there should be an evidence base to support it, and it has not been brought forward. Now, we've heard from the Scottish Government that one of the purposes of this policy is to try and drive up vaccination rates amongst unvaccinated groups. There is no evidence that that has been successful. Indeed, the committee has heard evidence from scientists that compulsory vaccine passports could actually increase opposition to vaccination uptake amongst the vaccine hesitant, having the opposite effect to that intended. And there's been no response from the Scottish Government to that particular concern from Professor Stephen Riker and others. I'll give way to Mr. Cole-Hamilton.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful for the member giving way. I absolutely share the member's opposition to the introduction of these, which are COVID ID cards in all but name. Does he share my concern that the statement we heard from the Deputy First Minister this afternoon represents the gradual mission creep of this policy, that there is no evidential base that these vaccine passports actually stop transmission? In fact, far to the contrary. Did the member see last week the document in The Lancet, which actually said that whilst vaccines are excellent at preventing harm from COVID, they are ineffective at preventing transmission.
Murdo Fraser.
I thank Mr. Cole-Hamilton for that intervention. And I agree with his concerns around this particular policy, again being introduced without an evidence base. The committee also heard from the Scottish Human Rights Commission and indeed other organisations involved in the human rights space about the very serious concerns they have over human rights from this policy. Again, there has been no response from the Scottish Government to those concerns. We've heard from those involved in hospitality about a loss in trade of up to 40% following the introduction of this policy and growing levels of abuse of door staff, some of whom have had to walk off the job as a result. We've even seen nightclubs putting chairs on their dance floors to get around the rules. So disastrous has this policy been for their business. We've seen an app being launched that didn't work, first of all, and even now will not admit for the status of boosters to be added, and major issues over security and reliability. Presiding Officer, Scotland is the only country in Europe that does not allow a negative COVID test as an alternative to vaccine certification as the price of entry to certain premises. Even Wales, the only part of the United Kingdom...
Mr. Fraser, I must ask you to wind up now, please.
Even Wales, the only part of the United Kingdom that has introduced this policy, allows that alternative, and yet the Scottish Government are standing firm. We are alone on this issue, and we are not doing it well. Presiding Officer, this is a failing and increasingly shambolic policy. There is no evidence to support it, and it should be dismissed by this Parliament.
I call on John Swinney, Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, I don't really think, in all honesty, that Mr. Fraser does himself or his arguments any credit by the overblown hyperbole that gets brought to this Parliament about this question. Mr. Fraser said that we had provided no evidence that the application of this scheme had driven up vaccination rates. And I put on the record at a committee in response to a question from Mr Fraser the fact that on the 1st of September, 53% of 18 to 29-year-olds had been vaccinated. By the 1st of October, that was 64%. And by the 1st of November, that was 68%, which is a sizeable increase in the vaccination rates in the target population that we were interested in ensuring was the case. So the Scottish Government has brought forward the proposition of a mandatory domestic certification scheme that is proportionate and appropriate at this point in the pandemic. Recent data is a stark reminder of the challenges we continue to face as a nation. We have a strategic intent in relation to the management of COVID to suppress the virus to a level consistent with alleviating its harms while we recover and rebuild for a better future. The scheme is limited. It continues to contribute to meeting the following aims of reducing the risk of transmission, of reducing the risk of serious illness and death, and in doing so, alleviating pressure on the healthcare system, to allowing high-risk settings to continue to operate as an alternative to closure or more restrictive measures, and to increase vaccine uptake. Earlier on today, I was pressed by members of Parliament about the pressure on our National Health Service. That is a real pressure, and we have to take measures, however uncomfortable and reluctant we are to take them, to make sure that we are doing all that we can to suppress the increase in pressure on our National Health Service. Yes, of course I'll give way.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to the Deputy First Minister for giving way, Presiding Officer, but he talks about the pressure on our NHS as if these COVID ID cards are somehow the answer. As we know, as The Lancet told us, they do not stop transmission of the virus. If the transmission of the virus is principally responsible for a lot of the pressure on our NHS, then these are not the answer.
Deputy First Minister.
As Mr Cole-Hamilton well knows, this is one of a number of measures this government is taking to try to suppress transmission of the virus and to increase vaccine uptake rates, which, of course, if we have higher vaccine uptake rates, it means that those who are double vaccinated are at less risk of becoming seriously ill, which therefore reduces the potential pressure on the National Health Service. So this is a proportionate measure that the government is taking to address the very serious situation that we face, applied to a limited number of premises. Now, we keep the scheme alongside other baseline measures under review. COVID certification could potentially be extended to other sectors, as I set out to Parliament earlier today, or it could have no role to play in our measures. But that will be dependent on our judgment about proportionality, which is the legal duty that we have got to fulfil. The Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Amendment No. 2 Regulations 2021 were agreed at the COVID Recovery Committee last week by 4-2 to provide for the COVID vaccination certification scheme. I would invite Parliament to support the proposition that is before Parliament today to ensure that these regulations can come into law, that we can ensure that we have the necessary protections in place. Under the difficult circumstances that we still face, I ask members to recommend approval of the regulations. I offer my assurance that the measure will continue to be under review and will remain in place only for as long as is necessary. But it is necessary today to give us the effective means of suppressing the virus and to protect the public. And I invite Parliament to support the regulations today.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of 3 Parliamentary Bureau motions, and I ask George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau to move motions 2049 to 2051 on approval of SSIs.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and all moved.
Thank you. The question on these motions will be put at decision time. And there are 2 questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that motion 2048, in the name of George Adam, on approval of an SSI be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.